you very much for giving me the opportunity to talk to you about the UK's foreign and security policy. And one of the things that Ben and I were talking about when we were thinking about this session was how the UK would look alongside an examination of Ireland and Ireland's foreign and security policy, and the way you could tell a story about Ireland's foreign policy. And although I'm not going to directly compare with Ireland, I'm going to say enough, I hope, to allow comparisons to be drawn, so I'm interested in your views and comments. If there's anything that doesn't make sense while I'm talking, then just stick your hand up and I'll deal with the questions there and then. If there's anything you violently disagree with, then we'll take it outside after the lecture, if that's okay. But the line I wanted to pursue is that the UK, or understanding the UK's perspective on foreign security policy, requires us to think a little bit about where the UK's come from and some of the adjustments that it's been trying to make for itself, certainly since the Second World War. And these, it's been a fairly prolonged process. And I want to talk about the way in which there are also different visions of the place of work, because I think to understand why the British have a problem with European integration in general, but also the development of a European foreign security policy, I think we have to think about how Britain views its place in the world, or what the views have been of Britain's place in the world. And then to take a look at some of the ways in which Britain does its foreign security policy, to ask ourselves perhaps where the value is for the UK in involving itself in EU foreign security policy. And then to dive in and take a look at, you know, what the UK perspective has been on the specifics of the common foreign security policy and the common security and defence policy. And then to the end, come up with a sort of balance sheet. You know, what do we think the UK perspective is on CFS policy as the UK? And I hope by that point in time I will upset some of you that are the last few questions. Is anybody familiar with this cartoon? It's by a 19th century British political cartoonist called James Murray. Anybody know who the short guy is?
Napoleon.
Anybody know who the tall guy is? It's William Pitt, who was British Prime Minister, or the role that was akin to Prime Minister at that time. And the cartoon is called Plum Pudding in Danger. Plum pudding being pudding, something that you eat at the end of a meal. And what you can't see, I think, from that resolution, is that Napoleon is carving off the continent of Europe for himself, and Britain's taking, well, an awful lot of time. And what I think is interesting, not least because it juxtaposes Britain and France, and France is often being the referent for Britain, as well as a cause of considerable anxiety. It is a view which existed from, I think, pretty self-confidently from the 17th, 18th century, that Britain did have and should have a global role. And more than that, of course, as an imperial power deserved to have controlling the state in large parts of the globe. And that perhaps the British involvement in the continent, in Europe, was something which Britain had watching brief for, but wouldn't necessarily see as the core area or the sphere of influence. Gilray himself was sort of radical cartoonist, so actually it wasn't that, you know, the British had have this and the British would have that. He's always pretty disgraceful that you had, you know, two political leaderships who were carving up the world between themselves. But he really is a great cartoonist, and you can take a look at a whole series of images from him on the British Library website. So I encourage you to do so. And actually, in comparison to today's political cartoons, you'd be quite shocked at some of the stuff that he got away with without getting in prison. Anyway, the reason I bring this up is, so I want to talk about sort of sources of continuity and change in British foreign policy. So we can think about that, and we can think about Europe, particularly European foreign policy, that fits into that. And for the British, really, they've had to cope since the Second World War with some pretty major structural changes that have had to accommodate themselves as a nation, but also accommodate their foreign policy. They have become a post-imperial power. since the decision was taken to seriously embark on a decolonialisation process at the end of the Second World War, or started earlier, but since the end of the Second World War, that's seen a shrinkage of the British geopolitical footprint. Parts of the world from Britain has had direct control, and obviously the resources then available for its foreign security policy, but also the way it thinks about its place in the world. Since the end of the Cold War, because Britain also saw itself as a key European theatre Cold War player, there's also been the adjustment to the post-Cold War world. You know, it was a key arrangement for organising Britain's security and defence. It in effect shifted from a country that worried a lot about the globe, which was the case at the end of the Second World War, gradually shrunk in to worrying an awful lot about the North Atlantic area and the European continent, which was also a Soviet threat. So those two things have gone on, of course, which are two pretty big set of structural changes that Britain's foreign security policy has had to accommodate itself. But there have also been some key aspects of continuity as well. I think one of the most interesting ones that I want to touch on a little bit later is the institutional continuity in terms of who does foreign policy, where it gets done, and who really gets to set the agenda. But there are two things that I think which have haunted British foreign policy. And I don't know whether anybody can help me with. Is there anybody from Greece in the room that can do a decent pronunciation? Syrochilis? What are those two? No students of classics in here. Disgraceful. I thought Ireland is the home of classical studies, done in literature. You know, for the Greeks, these were two mythical beasts where if you were sailing between the two points on a narrow passage that they lived on, if you went one side, you got nabbed by one, and if you went on the other, you got nabbed by the other. In other words, they're stuck between a rock and a hard place. And these have been the two real problems with the British in their sort of foreign policy orientation. Europe, on the one hand, tacked too close on a city European foreign policy. Much of the British elite raises questions about the relationship with the United States, so the special relationship. Tacked too much the other way, the special relationship, and questions are raised not least by the UK's European partners as to its commitment to Europe as a political and economic project. So they've haunted post-Second World War British governments, and they continue to be important in the debate about Britain's in the world. So we can keep those two in our minds when we're thinking about something that the British have struggled with. And I wanted to make the point that Britain still retains, you may think it's rather sad, but Britain still does retain bits of territory across the globe, British overseas territory. British overseas territories in which it still exercises sovereignty. So, like it or not, and these are the bits that Britain can give back to anybody, right? Or it doesn't want to give back, Falkland Islands or Gibraltar. But you know, Britain still has responsibility for these strange pinpricks around the world, which means it can't entirely forget that it has a colonial past. And for all of these places that it occupies, on different bases, and we haven't really got time to go through them, but I'll be happy to talk about them later. It does give it a requirement to involve itself in those territories if needs must. And this has happened either through invasion, of course, by the Argentinian government, or it exercises a kind of job that by Akhtiri, which are Cyprus. There's some basis on Cyprus, interestingly, in the news because there have been boats sighted there in the last 24 hours with migrant asylum seekers. And this one over here, Diego Garcia, when the British Indian Ocean Territory is leased to the United States, features in lots of rendition flights, as well as a base for the US for bombing points around the globe. This is not to, you know, this is not in any way to suggest that Britain still has a global reach, but just to show that there are some strange and peculiar echoes of empire that still find themselves as part of the responsibilities that Britain sees itself as having within international relations. I like the research project, actually, it's going to be a couple of things to draw comparisons and contrast, but not sure whether I'll swing that. But it's also been a debate, and really it's been an elite rather than a public debate, about what Britain's place in the world should be. And most of these discussions actually start from this view about Churchill's view of the world, expressed towards the end of the Second World War, that Britain was actually a part of three circles, one of the influential in the three. Community of Europe, that's not the same thing as European integration, but having interest in things continental European. The Empire and the Commonwealth, in other words, having responsibility for former imperial territories, but also Commonwealth countries. And the so-called Anglo-American partnership, which some call the Anglosphere. So obviously, you get some overlap between some of those categories. And the point about this is that there has been a juggling also with the British foreign policy as to which of those is the most important, and how you balance one with the other. And the Commonwealth has tended to be the loser, and I won't talk about the Commonwealth today, not because I don't think it's important, but you know, we're focusing on things European here. But this vision, you know, that Britain has to balance all of these three, has actually come back into vogue quite recently. A lot of contemporary discussions in and around the Conservative Party about how you balance all of those, and of course a different vision of Europe. There's also been this notion that Britain should be the United States' indispensable partner, that it needs to be the US's closest ally, and what would make Britain meaningful as a post-imperial power or since the loss of its empire is to be close to the United States, because that would give a power influence. To act as a tutor, or as some put it, Athens to the sort of might of the United States' role, you know, to provide good assistance in helping to understand said rather patriarchy, if not more rephrasing these terms. But really, you know, to make sure that the United States is doing things in a way that is to Britain's advantage. You tend to get less of a discussion, although it's there, about two other notions of what Britain's place in the world. One is Britain is a middle power. How can it adjust its foreign security policy to its reduced circumstances, its reduced capabilities, and so on? That discussion tends to be conducted not quite in those kinds of terms, because what prime ministers tend not to say is Britain can't afford to do it all anymore. What they tend to say is, you know, Britain can do it all. We want to do it all, but you know, there are some areas that we want to prioritise. But the reality is, for most economic commentators, there is a discussion about how Britain has, in effect, moved to a middle power state. What a middle power means. What kinds of things can a middle power do? But of course, being a middle power is also significant and marks you out within the European Union, where we do have a significant proportion of states which are small or micro states. We can argue about the definition about that. But you know, Britain is going to stand out whatever institutional context it's in, even as a middle power. And lastly, and this is probably, let's say, the least popular view, although certainly there in the early 1970s, is the notion that Britain really should subsume its foreign policy within a sort of European structure, set of structures, and really that's the way in which Britain can most successfully amplify and pursue its own national interests conjoined with a sort of bigger European Union structure. That view was the view that's held by the Heath government in the early 1970s, and from time to time, in fact, all British prime ministers, with the exception of David Cameron, and including Margaret Thatcher, all gave speeches in which they said they wanted to put Britain at the heart of the US. What they meant by that heart, of course, has been a matter of some debate, but the current government's unusual, actually, in that sense, that we haven't had that kind of landmark speech. Anyway, so, you know, Britain's addressing or dealing with some structural changes, basically shrinking footprint. There have also been competing visions about Britain's place in Europe. If we look at some of the ways in which Britain still seeks to have contemporary foreign policy influence, then you can see where the legacy does still have some influence. You think about United Nations, UN Security Council, alongside France. Britain is one of two permanent members of the UN Security Council, and there was also a nuclear weapons possessing state. Britain is a member of the G8, was originally joined, one of the founders of the G8 by virtue of the size of its economy. And whether you think the G8 is of diminished importance or not, with the G20. You know, Britain is still part of that key council, which is supposed to be a reflection of sort of conjoined economic and political power. It's also a founding member of NATO and has remained very, very committed to NATO since its inception in 1949. And the European Union, for most British commentary on foreign policy, is another organisation rather than the central organisation that Britain seeks to pursue its common, its own national foreign and security. It's obviously a late NATO joining member in 1973, but now is obviously having a debate about what its future might be in its relationship. And lastly, the UK is not unusual in this sense. It also tries to pursue a sort of linguistically and historically culturally organised set of networks for its foreign policy through things like Commonwealth, through the British Council and so on. But we have other EU member states that do that. France, we have Francophonie, we have the Portuguese Lisophone group, we have the same in Spain and so on and so on. So that's not so unusual. But for the British, as you saw with that notion of competing visions, it's been in some way as an idea of thinking more than just the cultural or the historic, to think about potentially as a mobilising device for Britain's role within international relations. So that's just a sort of snapshot of a very small number of organisations and memberships, but you see, you know, Britain's history bearing some imprint on how it sees itself having a set of resources that it, or networks that it can seek to pursue its foreign policy through. But it's also got some pretty, you know, pretty meaty resources anyway for pursuing foreign policy. And this is despite the austerity that the UK has been through. It remains globally the fifth highest spender on defence. It's the second largest owner of overseas development assistance, second only to the United States. And you may be aware that the British government made a commitment to retain its level of ODA spending despite austerity. It was a very famous policy area over the last 5 years. And it retains a significant diplomatic infrastructure. It has slightly fewer embassies in France, slightly more than Germany. But it's also expanded its diplomatic presence by increasing staffing in embassies in recent years, but that's tended to be in India and China, and that's actually shrunk the representation in other parts of the world. But it hasn't shut, hasn't had a major sort of embassy shutdown program. It's retained this global footprint. I think that raises all sorts of questions around how that relates to the European External Action Service, for example, and what the relationship is between states that have such a significant infrastructure for diplomacy and states which have rather smaller sets of cities. So, you know, on those grounds, you can see that the UK still retains quite a significant set of national capabilities that it seeks to utilise for its foreign security and defence forces. If you think about the sharp end of that, I think one of the things that has characterised Britain, certainly since the Second World War, is that Britain has been a country which has been willing to send to use force, people in power to use force within international relations. There have been some difficult moments in British use of force, Suez in 1956, the Iraq War more recently, and Afghanistan also. I'll come back to those in a moment. But it doesn't seem to be on the part of British publics or British elites any kind of retreat to isolationism or any notion that Britain might limit its desire to be involved internationally through military means. It has its NATO commitments and its NATO obligations, but also its national foreign security policy, it's generally reorganised its armed forces to engage in what we call expedition warfare, that's to be able to send people into harm's way and to support them once they're there. It's also keen to retain a sort of strategic capability in the area of nuclear weapons, that means the Trident weapon system and the Vanguard submarines that have been designed to deliver. And there's a commitment, which was until very recently, I think a few months ago, it was an all-party commitment to preserve that particular weapon system despite the cost. It's also committed to expanding its naval capability. I mean, I don't know where anybody here is a boat spotter. But Britain is currently building two large aircraft carriers, Queen Elizabeth class aircraft carriers, Queen Elizabeth and the Prince of Wales, which are two ships which are designed to give Britain a naval projection capability. Currently having aircraft carriers at Scranton. And those, the first one of those will be ready in 2020. So nothing happens between now and then, we might require that kind of military capability. So my point is that certainly in terms of big expenditure, Britain has committed a lot, quite a way into the future, both on upgrading its nuclear deterrent, but also its naval capability. And bearing in mind what I said earlier about different divisions of Britain's place in the world, how do we square this with the idea of Britain as a middle power? How do we square this with a policy that might see Britain focus on sort of European first targets? You know, what do these financial commitments and these ongoing budgetary commitments tell us about Britain, which is certainly pretty critical to lead, think about the role that Britain's going to have in the world in the near term? What has changed? These have been a decade and a half long commitments, is the retreat from Afghanistan and retreat from Iraq. That's been an interesting period for Britain because it's been a period which has been sustained military engagement in both of those countries. There's obviously been considerable loss of life, lots of national debate about whether these were good commitments for Britain to be involved in. But it's also provided Britain with a huge amount of military experience in theatre. That now goes, of course, and that having had that sustained high tempo to British defence policy and defence operation, Britain is now sort of coming home, and it now has or will have the smallest land forces that it's ever had, and the smallest number of overseas commitments that it's had since the tail end of the 18th century. Change from historically where Britain has been. And the overseas commitments which exist now, what used to be the major overseas, Northern Ireland was talking about military commitments overseas, but it was over Eastern. That's gone, of course. Germany is dying down, but Britain is bringing back forces that had in Germany during the Cold War. And it retains these strange bases, Cyprus being one. This imposed the Americans quite like British presence in Cyprus. Brunei, Sultan of Brunei, Britain basically leases Gurkhas, Sultan of Brunei, and Lots, British overseas territory. So Falklands is a major garrison for the UK still, although the numbers have gone down. There's been a lot spent there by way of infrastructure. So Britain, in terms of the way in which it's arrayed its armed forces, they're coming home. They're coming home in a way that you haven't seen for quite some time. The last area I would flag up, because I think this helps us to explain some of the aspects of when you get some curiosity in British foreign security policy, is the political economy aspects. And although Britain's economy has taken a shrinking share of the international political economy, the City of London is still disproportionately important for the British economy and disproportionately influential in Britain's view of the world. The pound sterling is still an actively traded defence industry base in the UK, BAE Systems in particular, alongside the car industry, are the major employers of skilled labour in the UK in the metal battery business. So armaments and arms production still matters quite a lot to the UK in terms of that sector of its economy. Now, finding the relationship between the political economy of the UK and its foreign security policy is really tough to do. I think you can trace that a bit on some aspects of European policy, and not least its attitude towards market regulation and so on and so on. But how can things directly on Britain's foreign policy? I think probably we best see that there is a focus now on all embassies across the world are basically tasked with doing trade promotion, and they've been asked to sort of dial the day's political aspects from us. And the Chinese Premier made a visit to London this week to give an illustration of the way in which that has been pursued. So you've got history, you've got the sort of structural adjustments, you've got the sort of resources that Britain still retains pursuing foreign and security policy. With all of those things, you know, how does Britain sort of map the world in governmental terms? And these three things, I think, are the three key documents to take a look at, three processes. And this is why I sort of start to make the segue to Europe and the discussion about European foreign policy. The first is the national security strategy. Britain has a national security strategy, and it sets out the kind of things that Britain worries about, the threats that it sees out there, and therefore the way in which Britain should be prepared to respond. And the interesting thing about the national security strategy is it isn't just about defence, and it isn't about the foreign policies issue. It's also about what Americans would call homeland security. So it's supposed to be broad, overarching concept. And you can see from the title of the latest version of the document that there is a view that you're not going to set a stage when it comes to worries about security. The other counterpart document is something that's the outcome of a strategic defence and security review. It's about the closest the British have to white paper on defence. And what that does is it sets out, so what you know about security and what you know about security threats, how does that impinge on the way that Britain wants to use institutions and resources to provide for its security, in particular through its defence policy? So this is something that's much more akin to the kind of documents that you find in the United States, where you have a national security strategy, and then you have some DOD type strategy that's set out how the United States wants to organise its forces. And there's also a process that goes with these. These are supposed to be revisited and refreshed every 5 years. So we're at the point at which we're about to get a refreshing of both. And we're in the middle of the process, or not me, but the British government's in the middle of the process of revising the national security strategy and engaged in this SDSR, its strategic and security review. And I think that's a sensible thing to do, take a look at the world on a regular cycle, think about things you worry about, think about the ways in which you might want to provide for your own defense. But the last bullet point on the slide is probably the key determinant. And this is the comprehensive spending review. This is the process that the Treasury in the UK goes through and says, how much money is the government going to spend? And what we've seen over the last 5 years is that in the area of foreign security and defense policy, the budgets have been cut. So the defence budget has been cut by 19%, and the Foreign Office budget has been cut by 60% in real terms over those 5 years. Because there's been a general squeeze on as a consequence of austerity, and the commitment of the current government has to eliminating Britain's budget deficit. So the resources are shrinking. So even though you may identify more threats, how are you going to square that? And one of the ways in which many people are talking about the future of Britain's foreign security and defence policies. There will be lots of nice shiny equipment, many nuclear weapons, nice aircraft carriers, but there will be no room to sail them or to fire the missiles because you won't be able to afford the salaries and that. That's a gross simplification of quite a complicated debate, but there are some difficult choices to be made. So, you know, the money or the austerity has played an important role in really making it difficult for Britain to think about how to expand what it wants to do internationally. And you may be familiar with you know, the sort of views that come across from the United States, which have expressed concern about Britain's shrinking defence budget, for example. So there's supposed to be the guiding strategy document. So, you know, next few months, you can sort of look out and see what they say. What's interesting for us is they do not talk about the European Union. They don't talk about the European Union in either of those documents. It's a key organising vehicle for Britain to provide for its national security or for its security, its defence and security. Lots of talk about NATO. And the European Union is mentioned on the margin rather than being central or integral to the way in which Britain has thought about organising its security and its defence policy over the last few years. So that's probably somewhat different from the situation. I know it's somewhat different from the situation which has prevailed in other member states, where common security policy and common security and defence policy would be much more central to rethinking the role of armed forces, rethinking postures like neutrality, for example, and perhaps allowing for pushing out in terms of different roles for armed forces. So, you know, the British have tended to think about CFSB and CSDP in quite different terms, I think, from other member states. So we've got, you know, the things Britain's trying to deal with, we've got the resources it's available to its foreign policy, we've got the ideas sort of encapsulated in its key documents. And then I just wanted to get us to think about, you know, who does the foreign policy making? How might this then allow Britain to interact with other EU member states? You can see from the reference that I've borrowed and adapted this model. And so some things in there you might find surprising in terms of foreign policy influence. The fact that media, interest groups, and public opinion, me, as a citizen, falls way on the outside in terms of influence on British foreign and security policy. Which is why, for example, we could have had the largest public protests and marches in Britain's modern political history over the war in Iraq, but the government's policy did not change. And if you look at the centre, then it's not the Foreign Office which is right at the centre of decision making on British foreign and security policy. It is the Prime Minister and his advisers. And we will be seeing at some point in the near future the outcome of the Chilcot inquiry, which is an inquiry that's been conducted on Britain's decision to go to war in Iraq. And a part of that inquiry, a large part of that inquiry, is going to look at the way in which government took the decision to go to war, on what basis it took the decision to go to war. And obviously, it's going to be focusing an awful lot on the first two circles, actually, in that diagram. The Prime Minister, his advisors, but also what the Ministry of Defence, the Foreign and Commonwealth Office, we now have something we call the National Security Council, and the intelligence services, how they facilitate the decision to but that, or this notion of concentric circles and influence, is quite a good way to organise and perhaps to convey the sense that Parliament in Britain, despite the fact Britain is a parliamentary democracy, Parliament does not play a leading role in Britain's foreign and security policy. It's the executive, and it's the executive in particular, organised around with the Prime Minister. The role of the Foreign Commonwealth Office, tends to ebb and flow, partly depending on the force of personality of the Foreign Secretary and whether he's a political heavyweight and makes his presence felt within the Cabinet. So like all countries, we have good and bad Foreign Secretaries, but they can be measured in the British context on, I think, the scale of the degree to which they have been able to exercise influence within the broad outcomes of British foreign policy, rather than just really finding themselves in a large and implementing role. You can see on that diagram as well that it hasn't been constructed in such a way that shows an interface with EU foreign policy. And what the British have done across time is to essentially find a way of accommodating their involvement in the European Union and the European Union's foreign security policy without really undergoing any major organisation change. changes to accommodate their involvement in the process at all. In other words, you know, the outward effects or the stimulative effects of European integration on British foreign security policy practices and procedures have been fairly minimal. We don't happen to discuss that at the moment. So knowing what we know about conflict space in the world, knowing what we know about the resources it has to do foreign policy, the ideas it's created for itself when it comes to the things it worries about as key strategies and the way it takes decisions. You might think there's absolutely nothing to say when it comes to Britain and the common foreign security policy in Britain and the common security and defence policy. Well, that's not the case. And it's not the case because, of course, being a significant foreign security policy player in the family of European nations, you know, that Britain is a participant, an equal participant in formal terms with all the other member states. And it does play a role in all of the EU's foreign security policy, common security and defence policy decisions. It's not like Denmark, which has exercised an opt-out on common security and defence policy. But all the reservations that we'll hear about in a moment on aspects of European defence, the British have remained full participants. Whether they have punched at their weight is another matter, and perhaps we can reach a view on that in the next 10 minutes or so. The predecessor process to common foreign security policy in European Union cooperation, the British were very comfortable with. They like intergovernmentalism, they like intergovernmental decision-making structures. And the fact that CFSP, some commentators have called it a rebadged EPC with a few knobs on. My best analogy is, did you serve the marathon bar in Ireland? The snack bar with peanuts in the middle?
That became something else.
Yeah, it became a Snicker. Yeah, and really, EPC to CFSP was the marathon becoming a Snicker. You know, different wrapper, but it tasted the same as beef. Still intergovernmental, right? And it's actually the same really with EPC to CFSP. You know, the intergovernmentalism and the core intergovernmentality for the British is important. And all the reforms that we've agreed subsequently through Amsterdam, through Nice, through Lisbon, the British have generally not found it difficult to accommodate themselves to. They've tried to play a role, say, in slowing down the institutionalisation of CFSP. They're trying to, I think, mitigate the development of institutions and structures. But they haven't been obstructionist, I think. They've generally been willing to play the game. And that's because they see the CFSP as a venue for the pursuit of national foreign policy rather than a replacement. And they've been consistently clear on that line since the early 1970s onwards. And even when we have governmental change in the UK, from Tory to Labour, from Labour to, from Tory to Labour, from Labour to Tory, Tory to New Labour, coalition government to Conservative, since the UK government, the governmental preferences haven't changed dramatically. They've changed at the margin. They changed around the Amsterdam Treaty, but not immediately. Britain did concede that you could have a high rep and could develop institutionally within CFSP, but it wasn't a really significant change. Defence, slightly different, and I'll talk about that in a moment. But on foreign policy, fairly limited spectrum, I think, of views, irrespective of the view of power, on power. And a consistent approach of Britain has been that it's favoured what it would call capability driven reforms. It likes stuff that allows European countries to do things in common. It doesn't necessarily like the idea of theology about foreign security policy, nor does it like the idea of building grand institutions. It likes to see the value of the policy driven by the outcomes, the outputs. Which is why, for example, if you look at the EU's diplomacy on Iran, which brought together Britain, France, Germany, and the EU, Britain really liked that. Not just because it was a participant, it liked it because it demonstrated, as they would see, an institutional flexibility and an ability to use resources of the member states in a way that delivered on outcomes that were good for the collective. So, you know, the British are certainly not the obsessed with the theology of a particular set of institutions and arrangement for doing policy. And that gets them into trouble sometimes. Talk about a couple of those areas we've talked about. But, you know, so, you know, I think the British don't have a fundamental problem with the existence of the CMS. We all should say, because, of course, the Parliament commitments the others in the state. So you wouldn't accept things you would object. And even when they've done a self-evaluation job on the CFSB, it's something with balance of competences and use that they're familiar with, where they took a look at different, last government took a look at different areas of foreign policy, including foreign policy. There was a positive assessment. It was sort of good for Britain to be involved in the CFSB, good outcomes for the UK. And there's a lot of evidence of the UK uploading its policy, you know, national policy, things it wants to see happen, uploaded to the EU. Zimbabwe is a very nice example, you know, where Britain had a difficult relationship. Zimbabwe persuaded other member states to in effect pursue a policy that was akin to the British policy on Zimbabwe. Downloading, in other words, finding ways in which European policies had more of an impact in shaping or turning British foreign policy in a different direction, I think was more difficult to discern. And that's partly because I think Britain's been quite effective at actually making sure that it gets its views built into what the EU collective positions are. Crossloading, which is an idea that, you know, sort of ideas and values might permeate within institutions, we might become more sort of socialized, climatized to a particular way of doing this. I think there's some evidence of that, but it's a little bit patchy. Partly because the Foreign Office hasn't institutionalized the CFSB with the heart of foreign policy in a big way. Fairly small number of people doing the CFSB in the Foreign Office in a kind of clearinghouse type operation, which means you don't have within the Foreign Office organised institutional locus arguing for more European foreign policy. Well, I think that's important, actually. And perhaps surprisingly to you, certainly it was a surprise to me, that even when Britain provided the first IRAP session, it seems to have had no discernible impact on British enthusiasm for the CFSB. Certainly did seem to increase the knowledge of the CFSB within the UK, as far as I can see. And so, you know, I think the British, even when they've had, you know, in some ways it's a diplomatic success, getting one of their own into that key role, they don't or haven't made much of it, I would suggest. Defence issues, you've covered St Malo, you know, so you're familiar with the St Malo process, you know, some might say Tony Blair's, well, most people give Tony Blair credit for two successful bits of foreign policy. Northern Ireland is one. Really claim credit for that. The other is really a rethink on European defence, and European defence policy arrangements within the EU. So, you know, that sort of impetus that government was interested in, different from its predecessor government, the Conservative government. But what you see when you look at Britain's involvement in the CSDP missions, and it's much more of a contributor than a leader. It's involved, and it's led on the Atalanta operation, in Africa. But it's not a major leader. It really has had, in the area of the CSDP, always the preference for NATO focused first. If NATO can't or won't, then the EU should be considered as a vehicle, certainly the military side of CSDP. And Britain likes these kind of capability driven reforms that the CSDP might result in, which, you know, it was interested in the idea of battle groups haven't ended up being a usable component of the CSDP so far. But that's the kind of stuff that the British likes. It's focused on capabilities, it's not focused on, as they would see it, sort of an alternative theology of defence, which is EU as against NATO. This is a snapshot of the military personnel that have been committed to the CSDP military missions. And the resolution's a bit poor, and the reference is dropped off the bottom, so my apologies. But you can see that even though, you know, the UK is a contributor, but it isn't the first order contributor. It perhaps isn't a contributor in terms of people and material to the degree to which you might expect, bearing in mind what I'm going to say about its capabilities earlier. So that's the CSDP military operations. If you look at, have a look at the civilian operations, and you obviously have a look at these slides in your leisure, it's actually been a bit keener, I think. And it's been a bit keener because I think there's been quite an active advocacy of the UK's involvement through the sort of development side of the British foreign policy community. And so you see that of the main civilian operations, the British have always sought to be present. They haven't always sought to be present in significant numbers, but they have at least sought to involve themselves in that. And I think they are comfortable with the idea, and like the idea that the EU might focus on the civilian side of the CSDP, and actually let the military side just slide away, perhaps into something which is organised and directed primarily through NATO. I think that's where they would be most comfortable in terms of how the CSDP might look in the future. And they do remain sceptical on some issues that other member states seem interesting. One is voting. The idea of voting in foreign security policy, the British would consider to be a nonsense. I'm using a polite expression there. They don't have a problem with the existence of the External Action Service, but they see it as providing a service, not as a putative replacement for national diplomacy. In other words, they don't see it as an organisation that might replace or displace a diplomatic activity on the part of member states in third countries. And that's quite important, because some other member states perhaps are taking a view in some places they might have the EAS to work in. European Defence Agency, you know, this body which is supposed to make sure that you get sort of smart defence procurement on behalf of European government, the British have been not keen on increasing the resources of the organisation. I think their view is that you want to wait and see, let it chalk up a few successes and then maybe we can look at growing the organisation. Absolutely, definitely, and remain unquestionably unenthusiastic, putting it in a characteristic British understatement, about the idea of EU permanent military headquarters. As it was put to me in an interview by a diplomat, we want shape, not shoe, meaning we want NATO to be military headquarters for military stuff that EU member states might do, not having it based within the community, the EU institutions. And there also remains to be enthused about two innovations in the Lisbon Treaty, permanent structured cooperation, because they think that actually, again, it should be capabilities driven. So they don't see a point in creating structures unless you get the capabilities first. So that's a particular reading of that. And the notion of coalitions in labour and winning, and they think, you know, that's the right thing to do. Why do you have to code like that in the treaty and potentially create processes that make it more difficult to do things if you want to do? And it's what the British do anyway. You know, they did it in Libya. So they don't have a problem with that. They have a problem with it being codified in a sort of EU treaty context, because they think that will stop decision taking when they're moving to quick decisions. So the balance sheet. The UK retains a substantial capacity for doing its own national foreign security defence policy. I hope I've made that clear. And so it tends to think about the CFSP and the CSDP as an optional extra, rather than as something central or integral to its foreign security and defence policy. And so you can see its footprint within the CFSP and the CSDP is not to play a leading role, to play a sort of contributing role, except perhaps for one standard case, for example. And of course, the big question at the moment is the shadow of the future. How does Britain's future relationship with the EU, which is currently being negotiated, how will that play itself out in terms of its future role in the CFSP and the CSDP? If you get a Brexit, what kind of relationship will you have between an EU which still has a CFSP and a CSDP and a UK which has some kind of different arrangement with the other EU member states? How is it going to fit? Because somewhere, in some way, you're going to have to accommodate the British as a foreign security policy player to the existence of those policy areas. So I think there'll be interesting discussions to be had if it comes to a Brexit as to how the UK will fit in. So thank you very much.